Hi there, and welcome to The Works. I'm Ben Che.
And I'm Ben Pelletier. Last week, we featured an ongoing community busking program that the Hong Kong Philharmonic is organizing to mark its Golden Jubilee in 2024. Later on today's show, I'll be talking to their chief executive to find out more about their 50th birthday celebration.
Also taking art to the street, in fact, he's keen to doodle anywhere he can, is British artist Sam Cox, widely known as Mr Doodle. He was in Hong Kong earlier, transfiguring one area in the MTR's Hong Kong station, close to where I'm standing, in a rare live art performance.
Space, the final frontier, the well-known introduction to the classic TV series Star Trek. For British artist Sam Cox, also known as Mr. Doodle, any blank space or surface is an invitation to get to work with his labyrinthine doodles. Last month, he transformed part of the MTR's Hong Kong station into a space station.
We kind of connect with people that are outside the galleries and museums and try and reach people who, you know, don't necessarily have any interest in art but just want to see something fun going on, you know. The children are going to kind of like add their own doodles and things like that, and it should be a really fun collaborative process, and their drawings always come out very kind of natural and not kind of over-informed by the world. This spaceship, and it's one of the first times I've ever drawn on something, you know, like this. I think the characters and the language of the work is very kind of universal and speaks to kind of everyone around the world, so it'd be great for aliens to see that too.
For his current solo exhibition in Hong Kong at Pearl Lam Galleries, Mr. Doodle in Space, Cox covered the gallery with 39 artworks. The show is a sequel to Mr. Doodle in Love, which was presented in Shanghai last year.
Hello there. This piece is the first piece of the exhibition, and it's got Mr. Doodle here, Mrs. Doodle, and Doodle Dog, and they're looking into the sky, and this is what they can see. Dr. Scribble and his evil robots and his cat flying into a vortex. And I think they're going to Doodle Land up in the sky in outer space, so they're very concerned about this. Here you can see Mr. Doodle and Mrs. Doodle and Doodle Dog flying in their spaceship because they're heading back to Doodle Land to stop Dr. Scribble from taking over Doodle Land and erasing the doodle virus and ridding the world of doodles. Well, it seems Mr. Doodle, Mrs. Doodle and Doodle Dog have arrived in Doodle Land now. There's chains all over Doodle Land. All the characters are quite scared because they've been imprisoned by Dr. Scribble. They've arrived and they've got their weapons of paint tools. Mr. and Mrs. Doodle and Doodle Dog are ready to battle Dr. Scribble, but he's got his evil army of machines and he's looking pretty angry, and this is the beginning of that battle. But who will win? It seems that the Doodle family have won the battle. And not only that, but baby Doodle has been born. This is the son of Mr. and Mrs. Doodle, which is actually based on my real son who was born earlier this year. And here is Doodle Dog, he's very happy. And Doodle Land is now being coloured in. I've called it Peace because it's celebrating peace in Doodle Land. And each artwork contains a small kind of story of part of the journey within space. So sometimes it's like Mr. Doodle getting abducted by these very happy aliens, meeting these kind of jelly boggle creatures. And there's also sculptures as well. It's a range of works that are quite colourful and detailed, and very happy making them.
Cox calls his doodle graffiti spaghetti.
Like an obsessive compulsive doodler. And I get very inspired by blank spaces. I like looking at like empty white spaces and just thinking I could cover it all with doodles. The actual particular style of doodling is always these little kind of characters or patterns. They're often kind of like monsters or creatures sort of moving in certain ways, and they all fit together like a jigsaw. And the process is almost like dominoes. So this is my doodle featuring the works written into it. I've included my self-portrait in the doodle, as I often do with my work and stuff, and I like to do that.
Born in 1994, Cox, like most children, started drawing when he was around three. His style and characters come from cartoons and video games. He studied illustration at the University of the West of England. Because of his love for drawing on clothes and walls, his tutor called him the Doodle Man, but he renamed himself Mr. Doodle later. Since then, he's run wild with the idea. In 2022, in a project that had taken 2 years to complete, he unveiled his Doodle House. During that time, he had used 2,296 pen nibs, 286 bottles of drawing paint, and 401 cans of spray paint to decorate every inch of his 12-room home in Kent.
When I was about 15 years old, I drew over my bedroom at my parents' house, and I would always ask my parents, can I draw on this room, can I draw on that room, or this piece of furniture and stuff, and obviously, like, they didn't want their whole house covered in doodles, which is fair enough, so I kind of always dreamt of getting my own house one day. So I bought the house I have now. I planned out how I was going to create this animation of sort of me taking over the whole house and running around the house and drawing over everything. It feels like being in a real doodle land, and I'm very happy that I was able to do it, and I'm even more happy that my wife was supportive of the whole project.
Cox lives in the Doodle House with his wife Elena, their recently arrived son, and their dog. He already has ideas for future family-based projects.
There might be a kind of baby doodle exhibition, but it depends whether my son really wants to, you know, draw when he's older. But I'm just looking forward to kind of doing more fun projects in the future, yeah. I think having a town that's completely covered in doodles, and that's probably the best metaphor I'll be able to create for this idea of, like, doodling the whole world.
Apart from the gallery exhibition in Hong Kong, Mr. Doodle also worked on a satellite event in a public area in Tsim Sha Tsui. It included 10 extra works depicting the alternative story of Mr. Doodle in space. On the day we filmed, Cox's arrival caused quite a commotion.
I feel really happy and energized by the spirit of Hong Kong, and this is my gift to Hong Kong, but to say thank you for all the support, so I'm really grateful to be here.
The more I've become this kind of character of Mr. Doodle and dressed up as Mr. Doodle and met people and stuff, I think I probably have naturally kind of become more positive about things. Sometimes it takes a long time and a lot of work, and you might not be able to see kind of the light at the end of the tunnel, but you just got to keep going with it. Then you can't lose anyway, because you're enjoying the process, and hopefully you'll be rewarded at the end of it.
Hold into the 10 Chancery Lane Gallery, you'll find yourself encountering the Otherworlds. Inhabited by angels, underwater creatures, and mysterious plants by artist Fuchsia. Born in Paris but raised in Hong Kong as a child, Fuchsia is now based in London. This is her first solo show in Hong Kong. The climate crisis is a major theme in her watercolor and oil paintings. Her angels, she says, represent love, vulnerability, and innocence, core elements in human beings that we sometimes lose as we become adults. Thank you. Light and Dark, Beauty and Chaos. You'll find them all in Fuchsia's works. On show here until the 12th of January.
Welcome back. Last week, we brought you Christmas tunes by the Hong Kong Philharmonic Orchestra's Trombone Quintets. They've been busking on the streets and in the malls in advance of the orchestra's Golden Jubilee celebration next year.
Today, with 2024 just around the corner, we're talking to the orchestra's chief executive, Benedict Faure, about what else they have in store for their 50th anniversary. With me here is the chief executive of the Hong Kong Philharmonic Orchestra, Benedict Faure. It's great to have you here. Thank you so much for coming in.
Thank you for having me.
And here we are. We're not even in a building.
Yeah.
We're outdoors at a magnificent venue where your musicians were just performing.
It's a very exciting place here at the Star Ferry.
That's right. And it's part of your Rhythm of the City series.
Yeah.
And all of this is also part and parcel and put together as part of your Golden Jubilee celebrations.
Yeah.
This year marks 50 years of the Philharmonic.
That's right. Hong Kong Phil went, as probably many people know, went professional in 1974. So this is our big celebration season after 50 years of development. And compared to other orchestras in the world, it's still not 150 years, but 50 years already to celebrate. And we have put together an array of wonderful soloists and conductors who come to our main stage concerts in the cultural center mostly. But also we have a lot of activities in the community. Hong Kong Phil is the orchestra of the city.
Can you maybe highlight a couple of the different aspects of this Rhythm of the City program? Of course, there's the Trombone Quintet, and they're performing a few different times, I understand, some other instrument combinations as well.
We have the Trombone Quartet who goes through the shopping malls, like the Mills, the City Gate, the Pacific Place, whoever you call them, we go into MTR, and we also go here to the Star Ferry. And the Rhythm of the City should umbrella our activities, which we do. So this is also something Hong Kong Phil tries to be very close to the community, and we want to go with the all generations.
It's so interesting that this mission, this educational mission, which you've mentioned with the children, and then also tying in with the Star Ferry, for example, is such an important part for the Philharmonic. It's an important core part of your mission, isn't it, as an organization?
Yeah. We are still working hard on educate people on music, educate in a positive way. We want to give them the opportunity to listen. And so every part is important to bring people, give people the opportunity to listen to music. Classical music, I mean, it's probably not for everyone, but everyone should get the opportunity to be in contact with it, and especially the young people. I mean, if the young people experiences at an early age, then of course at 15, 16, everybody has other things to do. But maybe then there's the chance they come back later and enjoy it when they are older, when they have family, when they can go with their kids. So this is something we want to convey to our audience.
Thank you. This is a very big year for the Philharmonic. It's not, as you've said quite eloquently, the 50th, the Golden Jubilee of the orchestra. It's the final year of Jaap van Zweden's tenure. And you have some quite exciting things planned for this 50th season, including the recent appearance of Lang Lang, and also some interesting touring projects. Isn't that right?
Absolutely. I mean, here in Hong Kong, especially as so many young people learn an instrument, it's also our obligation to show them that the big talents and the stars. So it's good to see so many young people coming with their parents to the concert. But now the season opened, the second part of the ticketing opened just now. So now we sell the concerts from beginning of January to the second part of the season to June. And there are also amazing conductors and soloists coming. If I may just mention some of the concerts. In January, actually, we have on the 12th and the 13th, we have a heritage concert, how we call it. It's the revival of the first concert of Hong Kong Philharmonic as professional orchestra. So we perform first the Beethoven Egmont Overture, then in the second half the Tchaikovsky Fifth Symphony. And then in the original concert they did Beethoven Piano Concerto, but now we have a Hong Kong Philharmonic chorus. So we want to include the chorus as well, so we do the choral fantasy. And other projects are then in June, we have the Flying Dutchman as a concert version opera. You all know that the Hong Kong Phil got the Gramophone Award for the Ring Cycle in 2019. Now this is the next opera Jaap van Zweden is doing, the Richard Wagner Ring Cycle. So we have the Flying Dutchman, so we have two performances of Flying Dutchman in June. And then the week after, the Farewell Concert from Jaap, also something new. The audience can choose out of a selection of, I think, 15 pieces what the orchestra should play. And this will be opened in January, the selection, so everybody can make a cross what he would like to hear, and then we make the selection.
It's absolutely magnificent to hear all of these things that the Philharmonic's up to, and I thank you so much for sharing them with us here on The
You're
Works.
You're welcome. Thank you again for having us. Thank you.
We wish you all
an early Happy New Year. I have to ask, can I play a short fanfare with you and ring in the new year? All right, let's go.